YouTube. We encourage people who are interested in the work of medical physics for world benefit to join and become members of the group. The website is on the banner, on the website, on the slide. It's www.mpwb.org. This is the second webinar in our series presented to us by Professor Hyman. It will be on technologies, opportunities, and challenges of automated treatment planning in radiotherapy for IMRT and for VMAT. We have a few panelists here. There's myself, Sarah Ashmig. Moderating with me would be Arjit Bagwala. And we also have Professor Yakov Pittman. And there's also Edward with us. The webinar itself will run for 45 minutes, presented by Dr. Hyman, and then that would be followed by questions and answers for 10 minutes. We would leave the last 5 minutes for final comments and thanks. We will have multiple choice questions sent to you. Also, we will copy and paste the link on the chat section such that you can click on it and answer the questions towards the end of the webinar. Once you submit your answers, we will send you a certificate of attendance. And as you said, the webinar will be recorded and posted online. Before I continue, I would like to mention that Medical Physics for World Benefit is a nonprofit organization. Our vision is a world with access to effective and safe application of physics and technology in medicine. Medical Physics for World Benefit's mission is to support activities which will yield effective and safe use of physics and technologies in medicine through advising, training, demonstrating, and or participating in medical physics related activities, especially in low to middle income countries. One of our objectives is to work with the spirit of collaboration by working with our colleagues, partner agencies, and national and international organizations to collectively improve patient care. Now we get to our speaker. Dr. Ben Hyman is a professor in radiation oncology physics at Erasmus University in Rotterdam. Did they say that right, Dr. Hyman?
Yes, that's correct.
He's a leading he's a leading professor in the field, and he leads projects on automated treatment plan generation, which he'll tell us more about today. Computer optimization of non-coplanar beam angles, IGRT, adaptive radiotherapy, stereotactic, body radiotherapy, proton therapy, and development of procedures and software for enhancement of patient safety, including EPID-based in vivo dosimetry. If you have any questions on the right side, so please feel free to type it, and towards the end, we'll read out your questions to Dr. Hyman and hear the answers. On top is the link that I was talking about. It's going to be on the chat box in the beginning of the seminar or of the webinar, and I will copy and paste it again towards the end for your convenience. And we'll also send it by email. It's a Google Doc form, and then once you submit it, the certificates will be sent to you, as we mentioned. We really would like to thank Professor Hyman for joining us today. And without further ado, I would give you the mic, and we could you could share your screen. Thank you for joining us.
So, can you see my screen?
We do. We do now.
You do? Okay, good.
We can see it, yes.
How can I get rid of this one? Put it here. Is it there?
Yep.
Okay. Okay, you can see it, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Can we see? Can I get rid of this one? and video panel. No, it's floating meeting controls. Okay, thank you very much, Sara, for the introduction. I would also like to thank all of the organizers for inviting me, especially Edward Pierskovic, who's also here, that I know for many years, and we meet each other in many places and many different contexts. I would also like to express that I think this is this Medical Physics for World Benefits is an excellent initiative, and this tool of these webinars are also almost made for this purpose, I would say, because many people from all kinds of different countries have access, and in a very simple way, and meeting each other live is maybe nicer, but it's not always possible. So this is an excellent opportunity. My talk, as mentioned, is about automated planning in radiotherapy. And so when I started to prepare this, so I gave this title, then I realized that a bit... do what I wanted to do. Provoke it to go to the next in this way. Yeah. What I realized when I started to prepare this is that basically this talk is about IMRT and VMAT. So if you look, certainly if you look at commercial solutions, automated treatment planning, this is, I would say, almost always or always about IMRT and VMAT. I think some of the solutions could be adapted to also work for 3D CRT, but basically this is, there is not a lot of literature on this, or I'm not sure that there are products for this. But anyway, my talk will be basically about IMRT and VMAT. So these are my disclosures. I think you have my PDF, so you can also read them. Yeah, first some definitions maybe, because I think there is a lot of confusion in treatment planning on this kind of things. So what are exactly constraints and what are objectives? So I will discuss a little bit what I mean with constraints and objectives in treatment planning. So anyway, these constraints and objectives, if you talk a little bit globally, there are kind of plan requirements or plan aims, but they have, for me, they have stricter definitions. So if I talk about the constraints, it means that this is something that you want never to happen. So you will never generate a plan that has a violation of it. So an example, for example, in our center, we would never allow the spinal cord dose, max dose, to be higher than 50 gray. So that is really, for me, a constraint. So then there is objectives. Objectives are aims that you have, that you like to obtain if possible. So that's very different from this one here. This is always, and this is only if it's possible. And what does it mean it's possible? For example, you don't want to obtain an objective if it is at the price of a constraint violation. Yeah, so you can only have the objective fulfilled if you have a constraint violation. You don't want that. Then you will not meet the objective. And also it can be that you will not obtain it if there is another objective with a higher priority. Yeah, so so it's really something, it's a bit softer, these objectives. And I mean, that is, this is an example, mean dose. Maybe you recognize this number, used a lot also from some studies, should be smaller than 26 gray. It does not mean that you do not accept the plan if it's higher than 26 gray. It's a kind of target that you have, but it's not absolute. Yeah, it depends on these kind of things. And so
other words that are used for that. So this could be called a hard constraint, and this is a soft constraint. So these are also words for that. I will use constraints, and I always mean hard constraints and objectives, and then I mean this kind of soft constraints. So this is the outline of this lecture. So I will first discuss Pareto and clinical optimality, which are important concept if you talk about treatment planning, automation and optimization of treatment plans. So then some words on what is the problem with current manual planning. Apparently we want automated planning because there is a problem with manual planning. Then I will discuss systems for automated planning and their validation. And then I will discuss briefly the question, is automated IMRT treatment planning, is this something to do in low and middle income countries? I can also explain what the background of this question is. So this, there is people that think that automated planning can be a solution in situations where there is not enough skilled planners to do IMRT and VMAT planning. And so then you could, according to these persons, you could maybe use automated planning. And I have some words to say on this, and then some conclusions. So, okay, so I will start with this Pareto and clinical optimality. And I want to explain these concepts with a rather simple clinical optimization problem. Clinical is between quotes because it's really very simple. So I have a PTV and I have two organs at risk in my patient. And for the PTV, I have a constraint. So it's such a hard constraint. I will not accept that any voxel gets a dose lower than 75 gray. So all voxels have to be 75 gray or more. And then I have for the OARs, both of them have a demean objective. The objective is to reduce this as much as possible. But again, obeying this constraint. If you now look at the solution space, it looks basically like that. So along this axis here, you have the mean dose in OAR2, the mean dose in OAR1 is along this axis, and then this is the plane of the solutions. You see a gray area and a white area. Well, let's start with the white area. These are unacceptable plans. So why are they unacceptable? They are unacceptable because they do not obey the constraint. And why do they not obey the constraints? You can see in this area, at least one of the demeans is very low. And if apparently I cannot have these demeans so low and also obey the constraints. So this area here is a forbidden zone. It can only be, you can only have these demean values if you violate the constraint, and I will never violate the constraint. So this is unacceptable, this area. And then there is an area with acceptable plans. Yeah, so there, this is the gray zone. And then there is this this border between the two, and that is called the Pareto front. And so all plans on these, on this red line are called so-called Pareto optimal plans. So what is the definition of a Pareto optimal plan? The definition, this is given by these two lines here. So if you have a Pareto optimal plan and you succeed to improve it for one of the planning objectives, then you will always lose in another objective. And you can also see that here. So suppose that this is my Pareto optimal plan. And suppose that I'm able to reduce the demean in OAR1. It means that I have to go to the left. But if I go to the left, I also have to go up. You see, this tangent is going up. So if I reduce this one, I will increase that one. And that is exactly what a Pareto optimal plan is. And in essence, it is the border between unacceptable and acceptable. So this is a mathematical concept. this Pareto front. If you look at the, it divides the acceptable from the non-acceptable plants, and the plants on the front have this this characteristics. If you improve it in some way, you deteriorate it in another way. So important to realize is that a plant that is not on the Pareto front, so a plant that is not on this line here, is never the best clinical plant. It's easy to see. Suppose, well, I have this plant. It's not on the line. It's an acceptable plant. It is in a gray area, but it's not on the line. And it's not the best plant, I say. Well, it's simple to see. Well, this plant here is better. It has the same D-mean in OER1, but a lower D-mean in OER2. So it's better. And also this plant is better. Actually, all these plants are better than this clinical plant. Yeah? So a plant not on the Pareto front is never the best clinical plant. So so now we are going to talk about the difference between Pareto optimality and clinical optimality. They are very different concepts, really. My statement here is that not all Pareto optimal plants are clinically optimal. Yeah, so they are Pareto optimal, but not necessarily clinical optimal. So if normally I do this discussion live, and then so it's easier to discuss. But I mean, if I ask people, I mean, these are three Pareto optimal plants, which is the best plan? Then the answer often is, well, this is probably the best plan. It's a kind of in the middle. I mean, you spare quite good this one, you spare quite good that one. Here, this one has the disadvantage that this is not very, very well spared. This one has the disadvantage that this one is not very well spared. So many people think that this is the best plan. And that is not necessarily true. And why is that? So to know what the best plan is, you have to know how important these OERs are. If it's very important that you get a low dose in OER1, if that is the most low dose here is the most important, then this plan is the best. If low dose in OER2 is very important, then this plan is the best. Yeah. So to interpret this, you have to know about the importance of these OERs. And you cannot in general say what is better. It really depends on the balance in importance between these two organs. So this thing that is this plant is a little bit in the corner and you would think is maybe the best clinical plan is not necessarily the case. That really depends on the ratio of priorities between these two organs. Okay, so this was the first thing that I wanted to discuss. We'll come back later, Pareto optimality and clinical optimality. So now we are going to switch to a different topic and discussing the question, what is the problem with current manual planning? Well, this is one way to kind of define the problem. This is a study of already some years ago, and this is a planning challenge. So what they did is, the organizer did is, they defined a planning case, and they very accurately, or let's say in a detailed way, described what kind of plan they wanted to have. And the closer you were or better, the more points you would get for the plan. Yeah, so it's very well described how you get points, quality points for the plan. So it was sent out, this case, and 125 planners sent a solution back. And if you now look at this plan quality score, you see enormous variation in plan quality. So although it was very well defined what should be aimed for, there was still this very broad distribution. I mean, the authors tried to analyze this a bit, but in the end, they came to some conclusion that probably differences in planning skills were the basis of this broad distribution. So So this is another way of kind of looking at the problem. So on the left side, you see a dose distribution of a prostate cancer patient, prostate SBRT. And this is how we performed our clinical treatment for this patient. And then we started to analyzing this with automated planning, and the plan you see it on the right side. And what you can easily see is that, I mean, here there is quite some dose in the rectum, and that could be much more limited if we did another planning, right? And also the bladder is better spared here than here. So this, so basically, I mean, we treated our patients in a suboptimal way. This is another example for vestibular schwannoma. So this is a benign disease. And so this is how we treated. This is how we could have treated. And you, so this is a benign disease. So one of the worries is induction of secondary tumors. And you see that the dose distribution here is much more compact than here. And so this was really, in retrospect, we would say, well, I mean, it's a bit pity that we have given this dose. We could have given this one. But I mean, we did manual planning at that time. We still do this. This is for the CyberKnife. We still do that manually. And so this is what it was. But I mean, there was more in it if we would have been able to do an auto plan, so automatically generated plan. So these are now, this I showed three slides that give an indication that indeed there is something not optimal in this manual planning. And so here I try to analyze a little bit. I will go through it line by line, don't worry. So what is behind the issues with current manual planning? So first of all, if you look at this, so planning is kind of solving a mathematical problem. And actually these are very complex and large multi-objective problems. So multi-objectives is you want this, you want low dose in the OERs, but high dose in the tumor. So there are all kinds, and there's not one OER, there's more. You also want conformality, you want dose homogeneity in the target. There's many objectives that you have, and they are conflicting. You cannot have full dose in the PTV and no dose in the OER. So there is a conflict between the two. And so this is complex, big and complex. And also the trade-offs between objectives are unclear and patient specific. So what do I mean with that? So suppose that you want, in some way you're not happy with, in a prostate cancer case, you're not happy with the dose in the rectum. And you do something to reduce, so you change maybe weights in the optimization problem, or maybe use another objective to reduce the dose in the rectum. You have no idea upfront what will happen with the PTV, what will happen with the bladder. You have no idea, because this is unclear and it's also patient specific. Another reason, another issue in manual planning is that you have an infinite number of suboptimal and plans. They can be Pareto or non-Pareto optimal solutions, right? So clinically suboptimal. So they can be Pareto and non-optimal, an infinite number. So you have to find, let's say, a very good one in a huge pile of plans. Those who plan know that it's also not so simple to know when to stop with the planning. And I mean, normally you get a kind of, it seems you get a kind of convergence. But for example, if you would add a non-coplanar beam to mention something, or an extra beam anyway, that then the problem can be completely changed, and maybe you can get a much better plan. And normally there is some template and you stay within the template, and then it would normally kind of seems to converge. What I see a lot also when talking with planners is that, I mean, what I call stopping too early. I mean, this is kind of a subjective thing. They don't think that they stop too early, but I think they stop too early. They stop when the constraints are met. So there is not a real attempt to get lower than the constraint levels, and also to work on the objectives. So the things that you want to obtain but not at any price, with the soft constraints. So the hard they stop when the hard constraints are met, and so they don't try to really get lower values, and also they do not always pay a lot of attention to the soft constraints. So, and I call that stopping too early. I can really imagine that they do it, the clinical planners, because sometimes they don't have time to work on it. They are already happy that they have a plan that is within the hard constraints. Yeah, another thing I think what contributes to the, let's say, the kind of problematic manual planning is that it's very difficult to write an unambiguous protocol for manual planning. So to describe exactly how planners should produce a plan or what type of plans they should produce, it's almost impossible. Another issue is that there is a large choice in options in the TPS for making plans. So some people use this, others use other options. On the other hand, there are also limitations in the commercial TPS. So maybe not enough options or not the best options. Another issue with manual planning, and planners know this, I mean, generally this is a rather slow process. And then combined with this one here, that you have a little time, yeah, there is not a lot of possibility to really, of not always a lot of possibility to really squeeze the utmost out of it. And then finally, this was shown in this broad distribution that I showed before, you have variations in planning skills. So, I mean, this is kind of a summary. There is more to it, little things, but it shows that there are many potential reasons for kind of not always having the highest plan quality when doing manual planning, and also variations in plan quality. So, I think it's quite demonstrated that automated planning can be a solution for some of these issues. So that is the next topic I will discuss, systems for automated planning and their validation. First of all, some kind of a definition of automated planning, at least what I mean with automated planning. So for each patient, the computer generates fully automatically the treatment plan for the patient. So it's a push button system. This plan has the highest clinical quality, and ideally the plan is also Pareto optimal. Ideally the plan is Pareto optimal. Alternatively, so I mean, a bit lower demand is that the auto plan is a good starting point for easy and fast improvement by manual fine tuning. So what you often see in centers that they use the auto planning to generate a plan for the patient, and that is a rather good plan. But they tweak it a little bit more manually to get it even better. And this is also a very interesting option because you get very good plans and the planning time is really lower than starting from scratch normally. Yeah, so this fine tuning is faster than doing a plan from scratch. And the quality is also more, let's say, consistent if you do this kind of approach. So this is, I mean, this is not the best, this is better. I mean, you got the plan, but this is also very attractive. So now some words on systems for automated planning. And so if you want to know more about automated planning and also about systems for automated planning, it would be great if you would have access to this paper. This is written by Mohammad Hussein, and it's really a nice overview of the state of the art. And this is, I think, in 2020. So it's really quite recent. I will also, by describing the systems for automated planning, I will follow the categories that were defined there. So this is these categories. So as you can see, there are three categories, and I will one by one, I will discuss them. So three types of systems for automated planning. First is so-called knowledge-based planning. So, I mean, the word almost explains it, right? It's based on knowledge. Well, everything is based on knowledge, so I should explain it a little bit more. And so what is so typical for these kind of automated planning system is that they use a database of planning CT scans and plans of previous patients. So they base themselves on previous plans. And what you then do is, for each new patient, you predict plan parameters for the automated planning. So you have a new patient, then you plan plan parameters for normally DVH parameters. So you plan the V60 of the rectum. You predict the V60 of the rectum for the new patient, and you do that by using this database of plans. If I put it very simple, you will see later that it's not that simple. It's much more refined. If you put it very simple, you look for a similar patient in your database, and you think, well, that patient will have the same DVHs. This is too simple, but this is let's say in a more refined way that is what is done. So if you have these predicted plan parameters, so what should be achievable for the patient, you use them for automated planning. So you do first the predictions of what is feasible for the patient, and then you use these parameters in auto planning. I will come back more in detail later. So then the second group of automated planning systems is so-called protocol-based automatic iterative optimization. This is maybe kind of not very intuitive terminology, but the way it's done is very intuitive, I would say, and I will try to explain it here. So what systems that use this, they claim that they simulate human planning. So what they did is it is an iterative trial and error planning. But then, I mean, if we do trial and error planning, it's manual, but now there is an algorithm that steers this trial and error planning. So you get multiple consecutive automatic plan generations. So all the time after a plan generation, it evaluates the plan, then changes some of the optimization parameters, does a new plan, etc., until you get a really good plan. So in between the plan generation, you get automatic adjustments of parameters, for example, cost function weights. So this is the second group of automated planning systems. Then there is the third group, and that is called multi-criterial optimization, MCO. And these systems always work with Pareto optimal plans. Yeah. So in these systems, Pareto optimality is not really inherently looked at. This is really explicitly working with Pareto optimal plans. And then there are two types of them. So there is in the paper by Mohamad, it's written a posteriori MCO. I normally use navigation MCO. And then there is a priori MCO, which I call auto MCO. So what is navigation MCO? So what in navigation MCO, you do automatic generation of a Pareto front of plans for the patient. So you do not make one plan, you make a Pareto front of plans. And then there is a tool, a navigation tool, and that helps the planner to select the best clinical plan. Yeah, so you have a whole bunch of this Pareto front, it is multidimensional, but it's not only 2D, there are more objectives. So it's a complex multidimensional front, but this navigation tool guides you through the solutions, and then the planner can select, what I put in between quotes, the best plans. As we all know, this is not very robustly defined, but a very good plan. So this is navigation MCO. Right? So you start with a bunch of automatically generated plans, and you manually select the best one. And then there's auto MCO. So in auto MCO, there's an automatic generation of one Pareto optimal plan that is immediately clinically favorable. So not a whole set, but only one. and that that's directly clinically favorable. So you don't have to navigate to find a clinically good one. Yeah, and yeah, these use, well, this is not so important now for this discussion. I leave this. Okay, so this makes it maybe a little bit more concrete. So here are, is again the three groups or categories of systems for automated planning. And what I put here are kind of known applications. So Rapid Plan Eclipse is a very known one for knowledge-based planning. It's by Varian. Then there's Pinnacle Auto Planning, that is Philips. And there's Auto MCO. I think we have a quite well-documented version of that. And now Elekta has implemented a similar, very similar approach as Rasmus Isaac. So in the following, I will discuss one after the other. So the red one, so Rapid Plan, Pinnacle, and this Auto MCO, starting with Rapid Plan Eclipse. So knowledge-based planning with Rapid Plan Eclipse. So, I mean, I pointed already a little bit on that previously. So the assumption of all this is that patients with similar anatomies have similar optimal OAR dose distribution. So this this is really about OARs, this knowledge-based planning so you predict for OARs. I'll come back to that. And so patient, if you have a similar anatomy, you have, find this, have the similar OAR dose distribution. I mean, I think this is very, very intuitive, no? I mean, if you have the same anatomy, you have the same dose distribution, optimal dose distribution. So what they do is they use a database with previously, so normally manually created plans to establish correlations between anatomy and achieved OAR DVHs. So this word is crucial here: correlation, anatomy, and DVHs. Yeah. So correlation between anatomy and DVHs. Anatomy is PTV. I mean, normally as and OAR contours in the planning CTs. So these are all used in to have these correlation models And the deviations are derived from the dose distribution that you have. So remember, you have this database with anatomies, patients, contours, and you have dose distributions. And based on these, this group of anatomies with dose distributions, you determine the correlation between the anatomy and the dose. And the dose is done the dose volume histograms. So these correlation models, you have one per treatment site normally, and that is done in this so-called rapid plan. Yeah. So what do you, so this is kind of the training. Eh? So you have this database, and then you establish the correlations. Yeah. And now with these correlations, we are going to make a plan for a new patient. So what you do is for a new patient, you predict OAR deviations based on the contours in the planning CT scan. And you have to do this, you use these correlations. So you have a new anatomy, and the patient has so there is a new anatomy, and you predict the OAR deviations based on the correlations that you established in the training. So you know which anatomy, for all anatomies, what deviations they should have as for optimal dose distributions. Yeah, so this is done in rapid plan. And then as a second step, if you these predicted deviations, you use them to automatically generate a plan. Yeah, so first predict what is feasible. So what is a good plan for that patient, for that anatomy? And if you know what is feasible, then you use these parameters and these dose volume histogram parameters to automatically generate a plan. So this is, I will explain this a little bit more, maybe at least more graphically now. So first there is the training, yeah? So you have this database of previously treated patients. So this is about very schematically, you have N patients, one to N. They all have a planning CT scan and they all have a plan. And then in this training, so in the you make these correlation models. So you establish a correlation between the anatomy, so the contours in these plain CT scans, and the obtained DVHs which you derive from the treatment plans. Yeah. So this is really crucial, correlation between anatomy and DVHs. Yeah, and that is used in predictions for new patients. So this is how schematically the planning of a new patient with rapid plan ECLIPSE goes. You start with a contour planning CT scan. So you have the anatomy of the new patients. Then you also have these correlation models. That is what you previously did. So if you have the anatomy and you have the correlation models, you can, with this anatomy and these correlation models, you can predict the OER DVHs for the new patient. And then these OER DVHs are then used to define optimization parameters for the automated planning. And that is done here. So this is automated planning. And then, I mean, if optimally you get this way, you do an automated planning based on these predictions. And you get a final plan. Very often with rapid plan, what you see is that you do some manual fine tuning and then you have the final plan. So this part, upper part is done in rapid plan, the lower part is done in ECLIPSE. Yeah, very important I'll come back to that also. It's very important for all systems of automated planning, they need configuration. And configuration is time consuming, complex, not easy. So configuration for rapid plan, the biggest part of that is to derive these correlation models and also to convert or use these predicted OER DVHs in an optimization template. So derive optimization functions really for the automated planning. So this is configuration and this is also configuration. Configuration means that it's kind of basis thing that you have to do before you can automatically generate plans. It's training, basically. So this is a result. This is first evaluation for head and neck cancer. There's patients 15, and then the first bar is clinical, and then there are three bars that are for three different ways of making correlation models. If you look at this globally, that is also the conclusion of the authors, is that the plan quality is rather similar to manual. There's not a big difference, KPP is much faster because it's automated. So there was no fine tuning here. So it's really much faster. So plan quality is rather similar. This is a characteristic of rapid plan ECLIPSE. So characteristic of rapid plan ECLIPSE is that the quality that is used as for input for training is also the quality that you will get back later if you have new patients. So quality of the input is really very important. If that is not good, then your final plans for the new patients will not be good. So in other words, garbage in is garbage out with rapid plan ECLIPSE. So you have to really make sure that you use high quality plans for the training, for the input, so for the configuration. Yeah, so this is just to, I will not discuss this paper, but what you see a lot of activity nowadays is some institutions together try to derive a KPB model. So it's a very good, I think, initiative to kind of homogenize a treatment planning in, for example, a country or in the region of a country. I think we all know, I think we are physicists here, that I know and for sure that the patients that they treat in Amsterdam, the prostate patients in Amsterdam, it's not that they need another treatment plan from those that we treat in Rotterdam, but they get another treatment plan. And so it's a bit weird. With these developing these models together is really, I mean, it makes centers think again about, I mean, why do we have the choices that we have? And this can help to kind of homogenize the plant quality. Also, let's say in a bigger region, not only in your center. Okay, the next system I will discuss is Pinnacle Auto Planning. So this is Philips. So completely different from what I talked before. So I talked about Rapid Plan Eclipse, was very now Pinnacle Auto Planning, and another commercial system. It's based on so-called treatment techniques. And basically a treatment technique is a configuration of the system. So you need a separate treatment technique, so separate configuration for each tumor site. A treatment technique defines criteria for auto planning. It's a protocol for automated plan generation. So it defines objectives and constraints for PTVs and OERs, priorities for conflicting objectives, criteria for conformality, handling of hotspots and cold spots. It's all part of an optimization protocol. Yeah, a treatment technique is established with training patients, it is an interactive trial and error method of doing it. And the goal here is to improve on training patients, and that's also feasible. So it's different from Rapid Plan Eclipse. So this with this system, you can explicitly try to get better plans than your input plans. So there's not a direct link between the quality of the training plans and the quality of the final plans, of the new plans. So automatic planning is iterative. What they do is all automated. Yeah. So you can add, for example, based on, so you do a plan, and then the plan is evaluated automatically, and based on the evaluation, you can, for example, add regions of interest and associated DVA objectives to improve the plan. You can, another possibility is that the weight of a cost function is changed based on the automatic evaluation. So all automatic. And then you generate a new plan. So it's a loop, it's an iterative thing. In this system, there's no idea on Pareto optimality of the final plan. It's the system is not made for it. So this is an example, published example of a treatment technique. And excuse me, so this is for head and neck cancer. So it talks about priorities, talks about whether you're not or not you can make compromises with the PTV, dose volume criteria, and then cost functions that you can use. So this is some example how it can look like. It looks like a list, very simple. But effectively, this defines an optimization protocol. It's not a list. So this is how it works. So you start with some settings for the optimization problem. So cost functions, weights, etc. You do an optimization, you evaluate. You don't like something, then you fine-tune your problem, you add objectives. You can also change weights automatically. So that is in the treatment technique description. Then you optimize again, you evaluate, fine tune, etc., till you have a good plan. So this is an example of a paper on this. So this is a paper from Denmark. So they introduced auto planning in the clinic, and for 30 patients. And what they did is they had a manual VMAT plan and an auto VMAT plan. The clinician didn't know which one was automatic, which one was auto, but he or she could choose. And then the result was that in 29 of the 30 plans, the auto plan was chosen. So auto plan was preferred by the clinician rather than the manual plan. And the operator time was also reduced from 6 to 30 minutes. This already shows, this is not zero, close to zero, this is 30 minutes. So this means that there is still some manual fine tuning used in this approach, but still the quality, well, there is a considerable gain in time, and the quality is much higher apparently according to the clinicians. This is another study. This is for a partial best irradiation, and these, so political auto-planning always, and auto-planning was at least equivalent and overall superior, they concluded. And the manual planning, the planning time really reduced from an hour to 10 minutes, so a factor of six. So really a big gain. Okay, now I will switch to this auto MCO, so generating automatically a Pareto optimal plan that's also clinically favorable, one plan. Yeah, so system generated one plan. Okay, this is said. So this is how the system basically looks like. So you have a contoured CT scan, then this is entered into the system, and then you have this so-called wish list. They are tumor site specific, and so this is configuration. You have to really configure that, which is complex. I want to say again, for all these systems, this configuration. And so if this is a contoured CT scan of a head and neck patient, then it goes in here, then it will load the head and neck wish list, and automatically you get a plan. It's a push button chain. So what is this wish list? It looks really quite similar to a treatment technique in auto planning, but it's very different in how it's used. So this is a wish list that we had for some prostate cancer group. So I clearly discriminate here between constraints and objectives. So the constraints have to always be met, and objectives, you try to get it if there is no constraint violation. And also you try to get it with priority. Yeah, so the highest priority, one is the highest priority, it will much more try to get this priority done than this priority, which has a lower priority. So these objectives, that is very important in this auto MCO planning. The objectives have priorities, and they are really used. I mean, so when it starts making a plan, it will first look at the first objective. So the first objective here. So the first priority objective is for the PTV, and this formula here, or this function here, is called the logarithmic tumor control probability. It's a function that we use to get high coverage for a patient, and so then it goes. So this is what it really focuses on first. If it gets this done, it goes to the rectum and it tries to. So this is an EOD, it tries to reduce the EOD with a high K, means that it tries to reduce the high rectum dose. And this is about intermediate rectum dose. Then there is some, this shell is for conformality. This is a skin ring, means that it is to avoid high skin dose. Then there is rectum mean dose, and so on, it goes down. So the probability that this is realized is much higher than this is realized. So this, because the priority, this is more important. Of course, we find it more important that the PTV is okay than we have a low dose in the femoral head. I don't see it here. There is not a constraint on the femoral heads, but in these plans, it's anyway lower than the constraint that we have. And we don't find that it has to be really lower unless there is no price to pay. No price to pay means that unless we can have what we want to have here. Right. So the same wish list is used for all patients of a certain group. So this is for prostate cancer. So there's no patient specific treatments. And yeah, and these priorities that I show here and the volumes. And the goal functions and the goal values, they are to a very large extent tuning parameters. And so it's nothing in our clinical protocol says that this has to be 50% or this 30%. This is tuning. You choose these values in a way that you got hopefully better plans than the clinical plans. So this is trial and error tuning. And with a nice word, this is configuration. Again, this word configuration that makes auto planning non-trivial. So Erasmus ASCO has been validated for many tumor sites by comparison with manual planning and clinical use in our center now since 2013. Some examples of how it works. This is a study very similar to one that I showed before. So this is about 33 head and neck cases. And what we did is, in a certain period, a part of these cases got a manual plan, normal plan, and an auto plan. But nobody except the investigators knew whether that would also be an auto plan. Yeah, could also be, I mean, most of the patients only had a manual plan. But some of them also had an auto plan at random, and at least for the medical team, for the clinicians and the RTTs. And in the patients that had two plans, the radiation oncologist could choose between the plans or accept nothing. And what we saw is that in 97% of the cases, the auto plan was selected by the physician for the treatment. So I mean, this was basically the first, so you see this, it's quite some years ago, basically the first study, and was, of course, I mean, this was really successful, and that was really prompted the department to start doing this clinically. This is another example of another validation of auto MCO with our system. This is data for 34 locally advanced cervical cancer cases. So we compared auto VMAT, automatically generated VMAT, with automatically generated IMRT, and with manually generated VMAT, and also with manually generated IMRT, and this was the clinical plan. So in clinic, we did this, and then later we also made manually a VMAT plan, and we did this automatically. And this is kind of an output of this study. So here you see the treatment technique. So this all is automated, this is manual. So this is IMRT, this is VMAT, IMR, this is clinical, so this is IMRT. So the most important parameter for our study was the small bowel V45. And you see, everything is normalized to auto VMAT. You see, so this is the clinical plan. You see that the clinical plan is let's say the automated plan has 35% lower small bowel V45. Sorry, has 35% higher small bowel V45 than the automatically generated VMAT plan. Yeah, so there's a big thing here also. This parameter, so the conformity is apparently better, and all others are kind of similar. And but our target was really to reduce this with automated planning, and we really succeeded going from here to here. And also, what you can see here, so this is IMRT versus auto VMAT, but we also compare manual VMAT, and this was really an expert planner. So this was simply the clinical routine. This was an expert planner. And we asked him also to generate manually the VMAT plans. And also here you see the manual VMAT plans are really not as good as the automatically generated VMAT plans. Last example. So this is automated VMAT versus manual VMAT. This is for 30 prostate cancer patients, and they treated because it was done in Vienna. They treated prostate vesicles and elective nodes. And so these are average DVHs for 30 patients. What I want to point out here is that, so the dashed is always auto, the manual is, the dashed is manual, the solid is auto. So for example, this is bladder. And you see, on average, there was a huge reduction in auto planning for the bladder dose. And also for the rectum, there was reduction. But here in this patient group, bladder was really, there was a big gain for bladder. And this is for an example patient. So this is the auto plan. You see there is a hole here in the bladder, while here there is really dose in the bladder. It was really, again, convincing evidence that So if you look at all these results of clinically tested system, I think the overall conclusion is you can get a huge reduction in planning workload. Also, if you manually fine tune the plans, so you can still get very good plan quality if you fine tune, with a lot of gain in time. And if you look at the plan quality compared to manual, that depends really on the system and the study and or on the configuration. So two of the systems that I described really have inherently the opportunity to get better than the training plans, and one system inherently will give you the same quality as the training plans. Okay, so finally, this question of automated IMT VMAP planning in low and middle income countries. my answer to this is, my take on it is, the first one is a really obvious one. For sure, if all tools, procedures, knowledge, and skills for high precision radiotherapy are available. So you need high quality LINAC QA, good contouring, good immobilization, proper margins, use of IGRT. You need this auto planning. Good planning, but it's only one of the things that you need. And then you also have to be able to really properly evaluate these plans. So I think in any case, not only low and middle income countries, this is what you need if you want to safely and effectively use IMRT or VMAP. I think it's no point to make very sharp automated IMRT VMAP plans if your LINAC QA is not good in place, if you have really problems with IGRT, and then you may even deteriorate the treatment. So I think my message here is, it's not about planning. The whole chain has to be okay. Yeah, otherwise potentially dangerous for patients. First, make sure that the conditions are met. And the conditions, what I mean by that is that you do that you have proper LINAC QA in place. And proper means proper for this high precision IMT VMAP planning, right? Often 3D CRT is more forgiving. And IMRT VMAT, if it's very sharp, it may not be forgiven. So another aspect, another option may be collaborate on some aspects, collaborate with others. So try configurations of other centers. So you could use, for example, for rapid plan, you can use the prediction model of another center. I mean, you can do that, but still, I mean, you have to then, at least this is also very important. You have to be really have enough skills in evaluating these plans, looking at the caveats and all this, but maybe risky. I mean, a bit further is adapt configurations of others. So you get a configuration of a center and you try to work on it yourself. Needs a lot of knowledge to do this. And maybe this can also be an interesting option to build up knowledge with a group of centers. But it's not only about auto planning. If you have your proper configuration, very nice. But I mean, if your system and the rest of your infrastructure is not made for it, it's not tailored to it, you may deteriorate your treatments. So safe and effective high precision radiotherapy with IMT VMAT requires more than a good auto plan. That is my conclusion here. Of course, I mean, this is an opinion, and I'm happy to discuss that if there is some kind of questions about that. So in this context, I want to go to a website by MD Anderson. This is about radiation planning assistance. So this is about treatment planning, automated treatment planning. It's web-based, and it says that it has a focus on low and middle income countries. So what I read somewhere, so that they want, this is not clinical yet, I think I mentioned that. And so they want to make it kind of, I mean, it's not for free, as I understand it, but they want to make it in a way, in a kind of non-profit way, affordable for many. This is what is my take on it, my understanding of it. So but anyway, maybe interesting for some to have a look at this. So, I mean, this is a paper, this is a paper on, this is a paper on this system. There are several papers on this system, and this is taken from that paper. So it says that it uses, so it does not have, so in some way it uses rapid plan, so the variant model. So this planning assistant, I mean, for the optimization, it uses the rapid plan model, it says. And then the idea is that you use prediction models provided by RPA. Yeah, so I mean, I think I already explained that. I believe that to validate whether this is an option for any center is not trivial. My conclusion, so auto-planning for IMRT and VMAT is highly promising. You get a vast reduction of planning workload, and you can get, if you do it well, a consistent high plan quality. And safe and effective application requires more than a good plan. I already said that. So there is a lot of infrastructural and knowledge things that have to be met. I think this is the last slide. I thank you very much. I will stop sharing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hyman. I think Arjit is going to read out loud the questions and the comments that we received from the audience, from the attendees. And after that, I will close with the final remarks.
There you go. Yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Hyman. That was a really great talk. The first one is more of a comment. It said, thank you. And I think up to this time, based on data of several planning competitions, man provided better plans than auto. Currently, humans are performing better than most automated plans.
Right. Okay. This participant has my email address. I would like to receive this paper.
Sure.
But I think in the end, I was also a bit careful. I mentioned that you can have got a great plan quality if you do it well. And so... I'm not sure that, the papers that I know, that is also kind of publication bias, but I've never seen a paper that is worse. But that doesn't mean a great thing, maybe. And so, I mean, if there is such a paper, I would be really interested to receive it. Thank you very
My
much.
My understanding is he was basing it more on the competitions that they have, right? Like the Prono and all that, not on paper. Is it possible that maybe his experience is more with like knowledge-based planning, like, and as you said, if it's garbage in, then it would be garbage out. So if they didn't have a good plan to begin with, to put
it in. And also what I also can say maybe about this is the following. So, I mean, what I know about is not very much about these challenges, but I've seen some, and they very well defined what they want to see. Very, very, let's say, detailed. But if this is not what you expect in the clinic, and you just run your automatic system for what you want in the clinic, that will not be a good match. Right? So, I mean, I can give you an example. So at some point, so we use this automated planning clinically. And at some point, sometimes things are very vague here. And I hear that, I mean, they had to change all these plans, these automatically generated plans. I thought, what is this? And then it turned out that the clinicians had decided to have other requirements for the plans they want to have. So, I mean, we continued with these automatic plans, excellent for the old prescriptions, but not for the new prescriptions. And I think this is kind of similar, maybe, that so in these planning challenges. So if you simply use what you, as you simply send in the quality that you expect for of your in your clinic, it can completely go completely wrong. I mean, as I mentioned also, I mean, in different clinics, I mean, the expectations of what they want to see can be quite different.
Yep. The next question was, what would be the problem issues with order planning as well? But I think you've talked about that in quite detail. Then there is a question. It's like a little bit long, but it says, I'm all for order planning, but it can turn into a video game at some point. So adding in the issues with delivery to a patient should be considered. LINAC limitations, primary BREEAM modeling can vary greatly depending on the TPS, DLG, leakage, transmission, and using non-coplanar fields adds to delivery complexity. Have you added any limits for the auto planning that would consider these items?
I'm not sure that I fully understand the problem. Anyway, I mean, so the dose calculation engine and things that we use, so all this modeling is simply the clinical engine. So what we do with our system is, I have not, because it's a little bit of detail, we generate a plan, and then this plan is recalculated in the commercial, in our commercial clinical treatment planning system. So in the end, all the symmetry is the same, right? And also, I mean, it's not that we use automated planning to add a non-coplanar beam. We add a non-coplanar beam if that is something that we do clinically. So I'm not sure that I answered this question.
No.
But
that makes sense.
Perhaps he means if you have a human planning, then they would know that, for example, this patient does not, like, there are certain criteria that if you meet, that would be good enough without adding to the complexity of the delivery, right? Without adding a non-coplanar beam. So this way you can have, if you're auto planning, you can have a plan that looks far more beautiful than a manually planned one.
Yeah.
But on the delivery end, it might not
be. Okay, that is a very valid point. I have to comment on this one because I didn't talk about that. So yes, that is a danger. So a danger is that you get enormously good plans that you cannot deliver. And so in our system and probably, you know, and also the other systems, there is measures in it. For example, let me say this. So we do not allow profiles to look like this. And so very sharp gradients. So there is a smoothing filter in there. And always, I mean, all our plans are checked, but and certainly if we go to a new treatment site, we check, so dosimetrically, and that's a crucial, whether or not these plans are deliverable, whether we don't have this very high, let's say, quality on paper, but not in reality. That's an excellent point. Thanks.
I'll combine two questions, but people were asking any solutions for tomotherapy plans and why is there no scripting for Monaco? Or in Monaco, it's not possible to develop a scripting for automation plan.
Yeah. So I collaborate on some issues also with Elekta, with Accuray, Sutomo. And I mean, we've discussed several times maybe to do this and it never happened. So other priorities, it could easily be done also for Tomo. And so we have also, I talked only about external beam, but we also have versions now for brachytherapy that we have planned to start use clinically in half a year. There's also literature on it, and also for proton therapy, for CyberKnife, and
Right. Dr. Hyman, thank you for a remarkable presentation. What do you think, what quality assurance for automated planning solution should be performed for safely implemented clinically?
Yeah, that is, well, I think I mentioned, and I mean, I mean that you cannot only look at the plan, you have to look at deliverability also. And as I also mentioned, I think it's very important that this is in clinical hands. And here in our center, it's kind of in the clinical hands, but also in research hands. So it can happen that we don't know things and we continue with what we always did. And I also explained that. Yeah, so more in, So an important one also is, it's a, as we all know, I think, in planning, sometimes here you lose something, there you gain something. And so it's not that always that everything is better, right? And because that's simple, if everything is better. So, and if not everything is better, then, so what we always do is we do blind clinician comparisons. So we let them blindly evaluate plans. And so there's two plans, and before we start using automated planning to make sure that that let's say the balances that we have are okay. And it's not that you always gain with everything, no. So it's an important question indeed. I think that is really, really important to do. So it's a kind of end check, but the end check is really the QA, dosimetric QA, but it's also this, do we really improve? Is this the idea? Because there's no, I mean, people try, of course, to kind of have a magic formula that will tell you which plan is better. But I think there is not this magic formula that is generally accepted. And so the clinicians for us are the grand truths. It's also questionable maybe, but yeah, that is how we work.
Another comment that was made earlier was, this means good knowledge of radiobiological effects of the organs at risk are very important when considering which plan is clinically optimal.
So I think, I'm not sure that there is more knowledge needed than for, let's say, advanced manual planning. So, I mean, you have to know, well, radiobiology, I would, what is radiobiology? I would know, I would think you have to know about the evidence that we have on those effect relationships, right? That is important. But in the end, it's always a mixture of things. And so, yeah, maybe very weak, but we ask our clinicians, you have to say it. I mean, cannot decide for you to change the kind of treatment approach if you think it's not good. And so yes, I mean, knowledge of those effect relationships is of course important. And but yeah, it also comes to balances.
All right, the last question is, when autoplan is performed for IMRT plans, will the TPS automatically define gantry angles, field size, or does it have a limitation in field number of fields?
So what I talked about today is nothing about beam angle optimization. So beam angle optimization is not in any commercial system. Our system has beam angle optimization. We have used that clinically, but not a lot because normally things are VMAT nowadays. And so in the commercial systems, you have to yourself choose the beam angles.
And I think Dr. Yakov has a question, comment.
Yeah, hi, Ben. Excellent presentation. From all the parameters that you put into the system, is there any way to address issues of error tolerances, for instance, in immobilization and so on, because different plants may be more sensitive to positioning errors and...
So there's nothing in the system kind of, let's say, to, I think you're pointing at that, to make sure that the plants are robust, no? And so that is also one of the things that you have to check before you start using these distributions. And I must say, this is also the reason I think why it didn't come up to me. We have never not used them because we saw issues of robustness. But I mean, I don't guarantee that maybe there are issues. I must honestly say, I don't know, but it's an excellent point. And because these distributions, I mean, the more you work on these things, and the sharper they get, the higher the gradients. And so you may end up with robustness issues. I'm thinking now, Jakob. Normally for the highest priority organs at risk, I would say you would spare them better. So maybe I would not be, in first instance, very much afraid for the OERs, but the targets may be more. I don't know what you think about this, but it could be that there's more sensitive for that, because there's dangers in all these things. So as we all know, we don't know where the target is, right? We do know that we get sharper and sharper with these gradients and smaller and smaller high dose volumes that we know that we're working on. So this is always, I would think, a limitation of anything you do to reduce the high dose volume.
Yeah, this brings into the picture that planning by itself is only one part of the equation. Immobilization, continuous monitoring of patient positioning and all that, all those aspects are very critical. So in implementing improved planning, this all have to be considered. And I think you made mention that, all the other parameters of a good quality control program and so they are so critical.
Yes. Yes, it's absolutely not. I fully agree with you. It's not to this is not to take it light. I'm also not sure how the people in MD Anderson feel about this and how they think they can cope with all this. And I have no idea. And it's not a plug and play and you have a good sharp plan and there you go. And
we do have about 5 minutes left. There's one more question about why is research machine learning not mentioned? A large automated planning paper was recently published in Nature Medicine.
Of research?
Yeah.
Yeah, a paper is not a product. So I know that they are working on this machine learning, but I couldn't find the paper on it. But maybe it's very recent. So I know I made this presentation a couple of weeks ago. I don't know. I couldn't find anything on it. That's then the reason why it is not in there probably. Is there a reference to this paper?
I think someone just posted the link. Thank you, Dr. Hyman. And I'll hand over to Sarah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hyman. This is this was a very interesting presentation. I personally have learned a lot from you today, and I hope that our participants also have learned. Regarding the multiple choice questions, we're going to send you by email the link, and then you will enter your email address and fill your name, answer the questions. Once you submit, you should receive certificates also by email. We would also like to thank the AAPM headquarters, particularly for Hannah Khan, who facilitated the Zoom meeting. We are very grateful for the support from our board also at Medical Physics Without, for World's Benefit. And of course, we thank all our participants and our speaker today, Professor Ben Hyman. Next webinar will take place in October the 20th. Our speaker will be Professor Paul Keel, and it will be about the cost effects of globally deployable radiation therapy. Same but smarter and radically different. So stay tuned. Thank you, everyone. And I look forward to seeing you again in just over 1 month. Thank you and have a good day, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Everybody is invited to visit mpwb.org and become familiar with what we do and volunteer to join us.
I will stop the recording.
Thank you.